Good morning, everyone. How's it going? All right, everyone, show your snow shoveling biceps. Yeah, looking good, man. Yeah. Snow shoveling biceps. Oh, man. So we took a big risk. We got out of the house last weekend because we needed to get out of our four walls, and we actually went over to the Creation Museum over in Kentucky. It was cool. It was really cool. It was really a God honoring place, and it was just great to be around so many Christian brothers and sisters from all over the place. A bunch of languages I didn't even realize. Like, yeah, my brothers and sisters from all over coming and you know, paying some honor to the Word of God. It was cool. So then we quarantined, and now I'm out of quarantine to praise here with my other brothers and sisters, with my local brothers and sisters. So come on and praise with me. We're not going to shovel anything for the next couple hours. Mike's going to shovel some knowledge on you, but no snow.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you, 'cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way. Welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. Make us new. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, are washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, Hosanna. Saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord. Come have your way. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Microphones do not mix. Good morning, everybody. It's good to be here. Glad that you are here worshiping. It's a good morning. We kind of joked that after the last couple weeks, I probably should have canceled church because it was too sunny. And, you know, the sun just really dangerous out there driving and, you know, the sun in your eyes and all that. You know, probably not, shouldn't have done that today. Hey, I'm just really glad to be here worshiping with you today. Just a reminder that today is the last Sunday that we are collecting the money for Mexico missions, the building project that we would have done. You know, I just saw Billy Hackett this morning and thinking, you know, Billy wouldn't be here this morning. He should be in Mexico building buildings, but COVID has pulled that back, and so the team he would have been on, he can't be on. If you have an offering for that, you can stick it in the offering box, which is where the mailboxes are. There's a box marked offering. You can put it there. If you've already mailed it in, we'll be looking for it in the mail, and then we will let everybody know what we raised after we get all those in. This morning I heard, got a text from Paula Marlowski. Nancy Bitticoffer went into the hospital, and Nancy had a medical need that required her to be there. We have not heard an update on that, but please be in prayer for Irv and Nancy. Irv couldn't be with her yesterday, but it sounds like he can be with her today. So we just want to be in prayer for Irv and Nancy. You probably have noticed there are cards on the chair. You probably had to move the cards to sit down. Those cards are there for you to look around. If you look around and you see this crowd here, who do you see is not here? And if you see and recognize that there's somebody who is not here and you want to encourage them, which we're going to encourage you to encourage them, we want you just to write a note in those cards. If you put their name on the outside, we will make sure that they get to them. We will address them and send them on your behalf. So if you write the encouragement, we'll mail the card. You don't even have to do a stamp. Just have to make sure that you do get the name on the outside. Otherwise, we have no idea where that's going. All right. And today, you may have noticed the tables around. We are going to share in the Lord's Supper today, and we'll be doing that after the sermon. But we wanted you to, if there's anything in your heart or mind that you feel like, okay, this would be a good time to prepare, to be thinking about what might keep me from really fully entering into a celebration of the Lord's Supper, use this time of worship to take care of that business. And if there is something between you and a brother or sister that you would want to be able to take care of, please take care of that as well, so that we can fully enter into this time of worship around the Lord's table together. Join me in prayer. Father, thank you that we can be here to worship. Thank you that we can be here to honor your name and honor your presence. And as we give ourselves to you, may we sense your leading. May we sense you're driving us deeper into your heart. May we have hearts that overflow in thanks because you have given us the greatest gift. And we want to sing our praise and thanks to you for this gift of life, this gift of love, this gift of joy, this gift that takes us through every season of life. We give honor and thanks to you. And we want to return thanks in every way possible, for you are truly worthy of all of our praise, all of our thanks, all the blessing and glory and honor. You are worthy. And we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Check, check. Howie. If you're hoping for a slow meditative morning of worship, you're going to be disappointed. Why don't you stand up?
Your love come down, earth my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. I once was blind, I could not see. Chains of sin had shackled me, but God in heaven heard my plea. Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. Jesus, Jesus, rescued me. I will sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. Now grace so sweet, it floods my soul, and hope eternal won't let go. My debt erased from Calvary. Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. I will sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. There's a home beyond the sky. A song we'll sing for all of time. The grave is empty, I am free. Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. Jesus, Jesus, rescue me. I will sing forever of your love come down. With my hands to heaven, shout your praises loud. I was lost in darkness when you pulled me out. I will sing forever of your love come down. I will sing forever of your love come down. I will sing forever of your love come down. Will sing of my Redeemer, He who took the nails for me. I've been purchased, I've been pardoned, bound to Him, I'm truly free.
I will sing
of my Redeemer, how He sought me while a slave, loosed me from the curse of sin and from the power of the grave. I will sing of my Redeemer, lift my voice to praise my Lord. Ransomed by His blood and mercy, I am His forevermore. I will sing of my Redeemer, He who bore my cross, my curse. Being a servant, chose to suffer, lifted up and cast from earth. I will sing of my Redeemer, lift my voice to praise my Lord. Ransomed by His blood and mercy, I am His forevermore. I will sing. Grace I've known here on earth with those forgiven, and one day around His throne. I will sing of my Redeemer, lift my voice to praise my Lord. Ransomed by His blood and mercy, I am His forever. I will sing of my Redeemer, lift my voice to praise my Lord. Ransomed by His blood and mercy, I am His forever. I am His forever. I am His forever.
You lived a perfect life, and Lord, that You died on the cross for our sins so that we could be reunited, and Lord, we could be, Lord, You laid Yourself down to be a bridge between us and God. Father, we praise You, we bless You, we dedicate this church to You, and Lord, on this last song, Lord, we just put it all on the line that we're here for You, and this church and our very lives are dedicated to You.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, whoa, oh my soul, worship His holy name, and sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Heaven may pass in whatever lies before me. Let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to
Dear Lord, we just pray a blessing on Pastor Mike as he brings us the word this morning. And Lord, just we pray a blessing on our own ears, our own hearts, our own minds. Just open us up to your presence, Lord. Open us up to your correction. Lord, open us up to your guidance and leadership in our own lives. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have come to the final sermon in the Reboot series. It's our opportunity to take this time to refocus ourselves, to look at what's happened over the last year and say, you know, this is a good time for a reboot, a refocus, a rethinking of what's happened around us. We've used this verse as a focus. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds. It's a recognition that there is a pattern that is available to us that is not from God. There is a pattern available to us that is not godly. And that pattern is the one that we need to say no to, and there is a pattern that we need to say yes to. And the only way that we can buy into that pattern, if you will, or work with that pattern, is if we allow our minds to be renewed by the power of the Holy Spirit. And it's not even just that we allow it to happen, that we engage in it happening. We do the things that we need to do to rethink, rework the patterns of our minds. And so we've talked about rest, because in rest, God adds life to our living, and engaging with God in simple prayer. The simplest prayer you can pray, or the most effective prayer you can pray, can be prayed in one breath. And that we belong and share in Christ's mind. Belonging means that we find ways to connect with each other, and we do so in Christ-mindedness. Obeying Jesus' instructions. This is of all the ones in the list, this is probably the one that's going to reorient our mind the most quickly, because if you do engage with Christ and you obey him, you're going to find that, hey, Jesus' pattern is very different than the world. So we should be able to find, even just by working with that one. And then ordering our life with holy habits. The idea that if we include in our life the things such as prayer, scripture, fasting, we could make a very long list here, but the point is that there are things that if we do them on a regular basis, they will help reorient our life. They'll help us reorient our thinking, and they will, in fact, reboot our mind into the thinking and the pattern that the Holy Spirit would have us do, and would then displace any conformity to the world. Today we're going to talk about thanksgiving for what God has done. As I started preparing for this week's sermon, I found myself thinking about articles and such that hit my inbox through email, basically always encouraging me, let me show you another way to give thanks. Let me encourage you to give thanks. Let me be involved with giving thanks. It's like I get all sorts of reminders about this, and I began to wonder, am I not thankful enough? Something must be wrong, because some people must not think I'm giving thanks enough. And I realized that as I kind of look at the broader picture of things going on around me, I think, yeah, in some ways, our TQ, our thanks quotient, has gone down. And part of that, I believe, is happening simply because as we continue to work through these unknowns that come with this path of COVID, and not just that, but the political divide and the social divide and any other divide you can think of, you begin to feel like, oh, there's only one mode I can be in, and that is survival. And I think that we kind of get stuck there. I was talking with Beth, and you know, Beth talks about a place where you can get to in life where you kind of amp up to it, then you get stuck there. And even if you get amped up a little bit more, when you start unamping, you just come back to where you were stuck before. You never kind of go back into this restful place. And part of what I was thinking with the Reboot series is I believe that if we will follow and conform to Jesus' way of thinking, we can see that needle begin to go back down. We can get below the amped up status. And actually, I can't think of a better way than upping our thanks quotient. But to do that, we need to decide that a few things are true, such as, I'm not entitled to everything in the world. So, you know, and comics use humor to kind of get points across. And so this one comic was talking about the first time he flew on an airplane, and the airplane had just begun to, the airlines were just beginning to offer Wi-Fi on the plane. And so just before the flight, they announced there will be Wi-Fi available on this plane, so if, after we take off, you can open up your laptops, you can do your work. And so people are like all abuzz about this. Wow, Wi-Fi on the airplane. And about 10 minutes into the flight, the Wi-Fi went down. It totally crashed. And the guy sitting next to this comic slams his laptop shut. He's just disgusted with the moment. And the comic's going, wow, it only took you 10 minutes to feel entitled to that Wi-Fi that you didn't know 10 minutes ago you even had. You couldn't be thankful for the 10 minutes of work that you got done. And I thought, wow, this is perspective, because when I fly, which is about right now 2, maybe 3 times a year, when I'm flying, I am so busy thinking about, I've got to make sure that the bag weighs under 50 pounds, and I'm going to have to go through TSA, and then I'm going to have to wait and hope that the plane doesn't break down, and am I going to make my connecting flight? And I'm going through all this stuff. And I went back to the thinking, wow, isn't flying amazing? People have found a way to get a 90,000-pound object off the ground safely. And that doesn't count fuel and payload. By the way, we're part of the payload. So it weighs that much more. Somebody said, everybody should be sitting here going, oh my gosh, we're flying. We should be amazed. And I should be thankful that I didn't have to drive to California. Thankfulness. Thankfulness starts with dropping our entitlement mentality. A newspaper columnist confessed, sometimes I'm grumpier when I stay at a nice hotel. And I thought I could have wrote this, because I was thinking about the last really nice hotel I stayed at, and everything he said here, it's like, this is true. I have certain expectations about the service that's going to be provided. I get impatient if I have to crawl around looking for a power outlet. If the shower controls are unfathomable, if the place considers itself too fancy to put a coffee machine in each room. I'm sometimes happier at a budget motel where my expectations are lower and where a functioning iron is a bonus and the waffle maker in the breakfast area is a treat. I'm just wondering if one of the things that COVID is helping us think about is this: what am I really thankful for? Sometimes I think COVID gets us thinking more about what am I missing, what am I losing, what have we lost, and we get stuck on that amped up part. But the question I would have is, can we flip the script and say, this is what COVID makes me thankful for? And Paul spoke to a group of people who were kind of on the amp side, and this is what he had to say to them. I want you to see these three verses and see what the thread is that is true among them. He said, let the peace of Christ rule in your heart, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. You saw the common thread, right? With thanksgiving, with gratitude, with thanks. It's part of what it means to be in Christ. It's part of what it means to honor Christ, that our lives become a center of thanksgiving. A center of thanksgiving, not just for what God has done. And again, amazing, right? What God has done in Christ for us is amazing. But what's just as amazing is the miracle of the fact that we can stand here and talk about it. The very breath that comes from our lips is the breath of God breathed into us at our birth. And we are able to speak forth praise. You are able to give thanks to God. You are able to form the words and consider the world around you and say, I have a reason to be thankful. But sometimes I know, and I can be like this, if I'm having a rough day, the first words off my lips are not praise or thanks. That happens. Or if I'm having just casual conversation, small talk, hey, how's your day going? Oh, it's going okay. I wonder what would happen if we flip that script and say, you know what, I'm going to make sure that I have ready the thing that I can thank God for in this day. Even if it is this, God, I thank you for coffee. And I thank you for coffee in that brother or sister that really needs it right now. The gatherings of the people at Colossians, which these verses are taken from, they were under a pressure. They were under an outward pressure to conform to their society. They were under a pressure to conform and to worship the empire, to worship deities, to be inclusive and tolerant. Does this all begin to sound familiar? They were under this kind of pressure, and that was the outward pressure. Then there was the inward pressure. The inward pressure was the false teachers who had come among them, teaching them things about Jesus that were not true, but they sounded plausible enough. They sounded like they could fit. And they're wondering, how do we navigate the truths? How do we navigate the pressure? How do we navigate the rough and tumble? And Paul's words were simply this. In order to navigate this, let's start with this. Let Christ's peace rule and be thankful. Of the 62 times that we find the idea of thanksgiving in the New Testament, most of them are examples of thanksgiving. There's only 8 times that we're instructed in terms of being thankful, and 3 of them I just gave you. And what that kind of tells me is that the example has been set for us to be thankful. People demonstrated thanksgiving as part of their life, but Paul is giving us this extra nudge. And this idea of letting Christ's peace rule in our heart is not the contentment that comes from knowing Christ. Actually, this is a term that only gets used right here, and it means let the peace of Christ be the arbiter in your life, be the judge in your life. And it has more to do with what happens between you and me, brother, you and me, sister. It has to do with the peace that comes when we need to be one and together and united. And Paul is saying, let the peace of God rule among you. And do it with thanksgiving. Be thankful for the brothers and sisters you have. Be thankful for the Spirit of God moving among you. Be thankful for the good news. But in all things, let the peace of Christ rule with thanks. And then let Christ's word dwell deeply with gratitude. Take the word of God and let it sink down deep into your soul. Let it sink deeply into who you are. And do it with gratitude because you have received this word. You have been given this treasure. You've been given this light for your path. Be thankful and take this word and do it with thanks. And then let Christ be honored in all we do with thanksgiving. Whatever you do, whatever comes out of your mouth, whatever actions you take with your hand, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus and do it with thanks. Giving thanks to God the Father. This is where this is taking us. It's taking us to giving thanks together in all things, regardless of the circumstances. Paul would talk about giving thanks in every circumstance, for this is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus. And yes, I know, it's not giving thanks for the circumstance. I have very few times when I've been able to conjure a thanksgiving for a difficult time. But giving thanks in the circumstance sometimes is as simple as, God, I can't handle this. I know you're here. Thank you for being here. And you know what? Isn't that sometimes what is also true when we are standing together? Sometimes you don't want the person to fix your problem. You're just glad somebody's standing with you. And can't we give thanks and can't we speak our thanks at that moment for a person who is with us? And here's what we'll find out. Where peace rules in our lives, thanks can grow. When we will conform to an image or to the pattern of God's peace ruling our life, that's going to create an atmosphere where thanks can grow in us. And where Christ's words find a home in our life, that's where thanks can grow. And where Christ is honored in our lives, thanks can grow. In other words, you're setting the conditions for this to happen. You're setting the place, you're setting the field. You're getting it all ready for when you have to go out into life and you're going to encounter things that you don't want to encounter, but because the peace of Christ rules in your life, that Christ's words have found a home in you, and everything you're doing, you're aiming towards honoring Christ, thanks has a place to grow. You have cultivated the field. You know, some of us are looking forward to the snow melting, the ground appearing, and then what are we going to do? As soon as we have a chance, we're going to start digging at the earth. Why? Because if left to itself, I can guarantee you this, I will grow a wonderful crop of weeds. But if I want something to grow there on purpose, something that might actually be of value, like tomatoes and zucchini and squash, if I want something to grow there, what do I need to do? I need to cultivate it. I need to dig in the ground. I need to uproot that soil and turn it over. I need to get some fertilizer in there. I need to do something to really make that ground receptive so that when I plant the plants or the seeds, however I'm going from, they will grow. Now, I haven't told you anything that you don't know. Most of you know that because you plant gardens. That is the image. That is the picture. Thanksgiving grows in our lives when we cultivate the plot out of which that thanks will grow. Where peace rules our lives, thanks can grow. Where Christ's words find a home, thanks can grow. And where Christ is honored in our lives, thanks can grow. There's an author, her name is Margaret Visser, and she actually gives three different images, but I thought about these images when I read her piece, and I thought, well, this also fits. So if you're not relating to the gardening, maybe you can relate to this. Gratitude is social oil. It makes things move smoothly. After all, giving and giving back are movements back and forth. When we're in relationship, this is what's happening. And if you don't have oil, what finally happens? The friction gets in there. It gets really hot. It gets kind of sticky. And finally, things just stop. Gratitude and thanksgiving between us and towards the Lord helps smooth relationships. And when there is no gratitude, there's no meaningful movement. The relationships become rocky, painful, cold, unpleasant, and they break. And the social machinery, Margaret says, grinds to a halt. But when we let thanks be part of our language, it helps smooth the machinery. Parents, I know that you're probably not in the habit of doing this, but when was the last time you thanked your kid for the chore that they did remember to do? But they're supposed to do it. Yeah. And we as parents are supposed to provide for them. Kids, when was the last time you thanked your parents for what they provided? See, that's, you think, well, that's just, it's just what we do. But you know what? Those words of thanks go a long way in building the relationship between mom and dad, mom and kid, dad and kid. Husband and wife, husbands, when was the last time you thanked your wife for that wonderful dinner? Wives, the last time that he did finally finish that project? And you know, so you say thank you? I know, it doesn't seem like it's like, but that's, give thanks in all things. Give thanks because it is a blessing and it comes out of a life that is oriented towards thanks. Brothers and sisters, gratitude can be like oil. So let the peace of God rule in your heart and be thankful. Soil, I just mentioned this. This is one of her images. Soil refers to the disposition of the person to be grateful and his or her freedom to choose not to be. He's able to cultivate in himself a grateful disposition, and an ungrateful disposition, by contrast, is hard and dry. It's not easily moved by kindness, unwilling to be kind in return. And in European language, people often talk of poor soil as ungrateful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly and let it loosen up the soil. I think her point is well taken, where that does not come to be a part of our lives, or where that is not in our pattern of speaking and thinking, then we ourselves can become hard and closed off. Finally, gratitude is glue. Gratitude helps supply social cohesion. It's a glue that helps us hold together. We're already experiencing a world that flies apart, that is fragmented, that has cracks and fissures, and we understand that those things happen. Gratitude is a kind of filler, a sort of paste that is amazingly flexible, getting into the cracks and then solidifying and strengthening the social structure. In all we do, let Jesus' name be honored and be thankful. As we work together, let's work at peace together. Let's work at words of thanks together. Let's work at the Word of God dwelling in us richly and then having gratitude towards God. And let us work in all that we do, word and deed, to be thankful. I know that as COVID wears on, as I said, it may seem like it's just harder to come by because we have to work that much harder. But if we are to conform to the image of Christ and not to the image of the world, we have to be willing to say, I'm not going to be living on this amp. I'm going to do everything I can. I'm going to work really hard to see it dialed back so that I do not have to live up here or beyond. It actually reminded me of an old hymn. Count your blessing, name them one by one. Count your blessing, note what God has done. Count your many blessings, name them one by one. You know which one I'm talking about. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Can you count right now? Pop quiz. Three things that you can be thankful for. Write them down real quick. Three things. If some of you had more than three, great, you had to choose. I didn't ask for your top three, I just said for three. Thankfulness, we cultivate it. We prepare our hearts to give it, and then we let it grow in us, and we speak it, and we practice it. We count our blessings. We make ourselves and remind ourselves of what has been done, and then we give thanks even for the ordinary. I was reminded again, just this simple thing. I know you're going to be doing it through a mask, but just do this real quick. Take in a breath of air. And then let it out. God, thank you that your spirit and your breath lives in me. Something so easy to take for granted because we do it every day. I said three things, five things. I make it a habit of finding things for which to give thanks. One last picture. I've thrown a lot of pictures at you today. One last picture is wet feet. A British preacher was saying, what happens when you fill a bucket full to the brim of water and transport it out to wash the car or to mop a floor? What happens? You are going to spill water. It happens. You're going to get wet feet. He said, that is exactly what our lives should be, that thanksgiving comes and wells up in us to the point that it is overflowing and it wets the feet, it washes the feet, if you will, of the people around us because the bucket is so full. And that which does fill our life will get our feet wet. So the other and opposite is true. You can be unthankful and get your feet wet with ingratitude. You can. You won't be pleasant to be around. But when we have cultivated thankfulness, and that spills out over out of our lives, it will wet and wash the feet not only of you, but the people around you. Practicing thanksgiving to God shows that we are growing in the right direction. A common word for thanksgiving is Eucharisto. That's the knowledge I just shoveled. Thank you, Ryan, for that entree. Eucharisto, maybe you're familiar with the word Eucharist. That's another name for this, the Lord's Supper. And thus, I think you can see very easily why this is, in fact, a celebratory meal, because this is a meal of thanks. It's not just because Jesus gave thanks, because when Jesus came and he broke the bread, he gave thanks and said, "This is my body broken for you." And it wasn't just that he gave thanks again because he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "This is my blood poured out for you." No, we give thanks because after Jesus served this meal, hosted this meal, gave it to his followers, and said, "Now, every time you do this, remember me," he went on to have his body broken and the blood spilled out so that we might share in God's life, both now and in eternity. We have reason to give thanks now because today in this place we can share in the life of Jesus. And that life can empower us for rest. It can empower us to engage with God. It can empower us to belong to one another. It can empower us to obey Jesus' instructions. It can empower us to order our life so that we conform to Christ's pattern. And it can empower us for more thanksgiving. So we come to this meal. We come and we remember that Christ's body was broken that we might be healed, that Christ's blood was spilled out that we might be saved. And saved not just so that we have a heavenly future, but that we have a hopeful now. And we live in that hopeful now. So, brothers and sisters, I'm going to ask the worship team to come. And brothers and sisters, I'm going to invite us, while the worship team begins to lead us in the next song, to come and partake in the body and blood of Christ. Each set of elements is in a single cup that you can pick up and take back to your seat so that you can take it there. But I encourage us to remember with thanksgiving. Remember with gratitude. And let that gratitude begin to break any hardness that might be in your heart so that you can cultivate thanksgiving in the rest of your life. Because it is for our whole life that Jesus came. For our whole life that Jesus died. And our whole life has hope because Jesus lives. Father, we give thanks. As we come to the table that your Son set for us, we give thanks for your indescribable gift of life. And we say thank you for filling us in every way. And now what we want to do is, by coming to this table and giving thanks and remembering with thanks all you have done, we would present our lives as well to be broken open so thanks will grow. To let your Spirit lead and urge us on so that grace will abound, that gratitude would flow, and that people would be blessed by seeing a people who have dedicated their lives to the Son of God, Jesus Christ, and to the goodness and the hope and the joy that comes from being in relationship with the King of all creation. Lord God, we thank you, and now we come. Brothers and sisters, the body of Christ broken for you and the blood of Christ poured out for you, I encourage you to take it from, there's three tables, one back by the sound area, one over on this wall, and one here. Go to one of those places and partake in the body and the blood of the Lord, broken and spilled out.
Oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on your grace abounds to me. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross bids me come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here, by grace draw near and bless your name. Oh, Lord, please light the fire that once come and die and find that I may truly live. Oh, the wonderful cross. Oh, the wonderful cross. All who gather here by grace draw near and bless your name. Oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your faith is all I see.
Grow in thanksgiving, and that as you grow, you will bless and wet the feet of the people around you out of the overflow of your thanks to God. Have a wonderful week. God bless you. Good to be with you today. Looking forward to the next time we're together.